Dr. Ungo returned to the country in 1974 and joined the Popular Forum, a coalition of political parties, trade unions, and grassroots organizations opposed to military dictatorship. In 1979, a group of young military officers staged a coup against General Humberto Romero, and a new civilian military junta was formed. Dr. Ungo, representing the Popular Forum, was appointed to the five-member government junta. A program of political and economic reforms that the new government had set forth was soon thwarted by right-wing military officers, and repression became the order of the day. In April 1980, the MNR, along with a broad forum of political, labor, peasant, and professional sector organizations, formed the Democratic Revolutionary Front. In his capacity as president of the FDR, Dr. Ungo headed the FDR-FMLN delegation to the first dialogue meeting with the Salvadorian government that took place in La Palma in October of 1984. He has as well met with the majority of Latin American presidents and many European leaders, including French President Mitterrand, Prime Minister Papandreou of Greece, Prime Minister Felipe González of Spain, and the late Olof Palme of Sweden, in the search for a dialogue and an end to the conflict in El Salvador. In 1987, Dr. Ungo and other leaders of the FDR visited El Salvador in order to meet with a broad spectrum of social and political leaders and to explore possibilities for a political solution to the conflict. In November of 87, the National Revolutionary Front, together with the Popular Social Christian Movement and the Social Democratic Party, formed the Democratic Convergence. And in August of 1988, Dr. Ungo was chosen as the presidential candidate of the Democratic Convergence. In April of 88, the Danish Federation of Trade Unions awarded its 1988 Peace and Human Rights Prize to Dr. Ungo, and I quote, "In recognition of the efforts made over many years by Dr. Ungo and the MNR in search of social justice and peace in El Salvador." Dr. Ungo is also the Vice President of the Socialist International, the International Organization of Social Democrats, and of COPAL, the Permanent Conference of Latin American Political Parties. When the Democratic Convergence participates in the March 1989 national elections in El Salvador, Dr. Ungo, who has had an alliance with revolutionary and Marxist organizations, will in fact be its presidential candidate. I present to you a Latin American fighter, Dr. Ungo.
Thanks so much. Anti-imperialism, not anti-communism, was several years ago in my country, in El Salvador, just an intellectual position of small circles, mainly Marxist circles. But in the last 8 years, anti-imperialism is common knowledge, is common reality in my country that is becoming more and more like a protectorate of the United States due to President Reagan's policy. But at the same time, the Salvadorian political and social popular forces have learned to struggle to make gains and to defeat President Reagan's policies, relying very importantly in the support of the American people. So that's a paradox, and we really feel very much obliged to all of you, the Americans, that understand that in Latin America and the Caribbean, You cannot be a Democrat if you don't go against communists, against anti-communism, and against imperialism. Of course, the impact of the Russian Revolution was not the same in the United States of America as in Central America. There were different social, economic, and political conditions, and the reaction was different. In El Salvador, we started to know the impact, the effects of anti-communism during the mass murder in 1932 of more than 20,000 Salvadorian peasants. I think it was the first most massive and violent expression of anti-communism in Latin America at that time. Then, mainly were internal agents, internal factors. The few riches, the oligarchy, and the army, the two were the main agents of anti-communism and of mass killing. But later on, after the World War, the Cold War contributed to export from the United States to Central America, to Latin America, the Caribbean, and to El Salvador, of course, a new expression of anti-communism. The doctrine of national security and anti-communism gave force, gave strength to the oligarchy and to the armies in Latin America in order to practice a so-called restricted and controlled democracy. Thus, anti-communism has become since then one of the main factors for containment and repressing social change in Central America and in Latin America. Since we live in misery, with high levels of unemployment, exploitation, and so forth, most of us are considered communist and subversives. So, the new export of anti-communism from the United States policy to Latin America has developed the concept of democracy, control restricted of the minorities and for the minorities, because real democracy is really subversive. Anti-communism made democracy subversive. This new alliance of United States government, oligarchy, and the army has been the main factor for the practice in many or in several Latin American countries, and especially in El Salvador, Guatemala, the practice of state terrorism. El Salvador now, since 1980, has had more than 60,000 casualties, but not war casualties, repression casualties, people not killed in war, but people killed by the death squads and the security forces of the government. And that was one of the reasons why, in the early days of the Reagan administration, some liberal Democrats and Congress wanted and succeeded appointing a special envoy in order to make some appraisal of the situation regarding human rights in El Salvador. And the complicity and the backing of this practice of state terrorism is clear when we have seen, when we have read the reports of the Reagan administration talking about the improvements in El Salvador, because now, instead of killing thousands per month, it's just hundreds per month or per year. Instead of killing, cutting their heads off, they don't cut their heads off. So, anti-communism has become, in a paradox, the main factor of social unrest, of repression, of destabilization, of misery, and of failure of such a policy. I just came here, no matter that we are living very difficult times in El Salvador and facing some sort of electoral campaign where we know that votes are not the main source of power. When votes don't count much, when votes are not counted well, so in a way swimming in a swimming pool full of sharks, in order to develop more conditions for a peaceful settlement, for a negotiated settlement, no matter the importance of being there, I thought it was very important to be here, because of this anti-communist approach is one of the main battlegrounds in Central America and in El Salvador. And because anti-communism is and is going to be a very strategic issue in the new conditions, in the new relations between Latin America and the Caribbean and the United States. There is a very close relation between social change, political change, and a change of attitude and of behavior in the United States regarding anti-communism. As I say, it's impossible in Latin America to be a real democrat and not to reject the anti-communist approach. No matter the difficulties, no matter the risks, no matter that we don't have a reason to be very optimistic with what happened last Tuesday, there is a positive tendency for new relations on different bases. We see everywhere in Latin America and in the world a tendency for more democratization of power, for more pluralism. In El Salvador, no matter that we have had anti-democratic regimes, the vitality of the social movement, of the political movement, no matter the killings, is impressive. So there is a tendency to be more pluralistic. There is a tendency for political settlements, negotiated settlements, and not through military means. And there is a tendency to multipolarization. The perestroika also is a positive perspective for relations between the superpowers. But also, the perestroika is a two-way road. All supposes, means, needs, changes in the attitude in the United States regarding anti-communism. In this sense, we believe that the perspective is positive. And Central America, Nicaragua, El Salvador are becoming test cases for this. It's a challenge because we see a deepening crisis, more popular gains, more failures of the American policy that tell us that we are approaching a turning point. It may be painful or not, and how much depends on the capacity of the U.S. government and the U.S. people how to react with a positive attitude or to keep the same anti-communist attitude. That's why we think that this issue is issue of life and death for the United States and Latin America and the Third World. Thank you.